Well, good evening and welcome. This is very exciting to see all of you here for the kickoff event for Silicon Valley Reads. I'm Judy Mitchell from the Los Altos Library Endowment, and we are honored to be co-hosting this event with Silicon Valley Reads. I see a lot of you standing in the back, and I want to let you know that there is an overflow room. If you go out these doors, turn left, and go right to the back, you'll see a glass-in room, and you can see exactly the same screen we're seeing here. So if you would prefer to sit comfortably, I recommend that room. So just briefly, the Los Altos Library Endowment, better known as LALI, supports Los Altos and Woodland Libraries specifically in a variety of ways. We have ongoing programs in science and technology. In the last few years, we've given over $300,000 to those areas. And we maintain also the Virginia Whipple collection of great courses. We now have over 1,200 courses on DVD and CD. So check them out. They're great. And then we do periodic grants. We like equipment purchases, laptops, iPads for Los Altos here, iPad table and chairs for the Woodland branch. And most recently, we provided the funding for the new mini mobile library, better known as Go-Go Biblio. Most of you have probably seen it because it's parked right on the left side here in the parking lot most of the time. But as the weather warms up, I hope you see it around town at community events. And be on the lookout and think of LALI when you see it. So those are some, just a few of the local things that we do, but we've been a supporter also of the district-wide program, Silicon Valley Reads, since 2013, And we have provided in that short time $32,000 for speakers and events for Silicon Valley Reads. So that's just a few of the things that we do, but I hope it whets your appetite to learn more about the Los Altos Library Endowment. And on the table outside those doors, there's some more literature there. You can pick up a brochure and learn more. Well, I know you're waiting for the big event, but before I turn the mic over, I want to thank Marlene, our community librarian. Marlene, where are you? Wave. Give her a big round of applause. She is our community librarian, and she and her wonderful staff, especially Cynthia Wilson, who helped so much in January while Marlene was out of town, they have done all the detailed work for this night, making flyers, checking out AV equipment, getting the rooms set up, all of that. So I appreciate it so much. Thank you, Marlene. And now I'd like to introduce a special guest. Nancy, can you come up? I'm sure you've seen her name, but I don't know how many of you have actually gotten to meet our county library director. She is in charge of all of the libraries, 9, right? In the Santa Clara County Library District. And she's also a co-chair of Silicon Valley Reads. So I'm gonna let her tell you a little bit about that and introduce our speaker. And thank you and welcome. Thank you. I was gonna tell you who the speaker is, but I think you already know.
Good evening. I'm Nancy Howe, as Judy said, County Librarian for the Santa Clara County Library District and co-chair of Silicon Valley Reads. My co-co-chair, Mary Ann Dewan, is here from the County Office of Education, where she's the superintendent of schools, and she's in our audience tonight to enjoy the program. We, the County Library District, along with our partners, the San Jose Public Library and the Santa Clara County Office of Education, welcome you to the 17th annual Silicon Valley Reads. For those of you who may not be familiar, Silicon Valley Reads is a community engagement program designed to encourage a reading and discussion about a provocative theme relevant to our region and I'm excited to present this year's theme, Finding Identity in Family History, featuring more than 140 free events in the coming weeks. There are programs planned for all ages, and they're sure to inspire. None of this would be possible without the support of our donors and community partners listed in the calendar of events. I would like to give a special thank you to the Los Altos Library Endowment for their support, and to Judy Mitchell, their president, who sits on our advisory board. Tonight is the first event of our premiere weekend with best-selling author A.J. Jacobs. A few years ago, as the story goes, and I hope he'll tell us if it's true, he got an unexpected email, a hello from an eighth cousin he didn't know he had, and that started him on a three-year adventure to learn more about his relatives and make an attempt to build the world's largest family tree. His entertaining and informative book, It's All Relative, is one of the three featured selections for Silicon Valley Reads this year. A.G. describes himself as an author, journalist, lecturer, and human guinea pig. He has written four New York Times bestsellers that combine keen storytelling and powers of observation with science and humor, including The Know-It-All, which chronicles the 18 months he spent reading the entire Encyclopedia Britannica. I believe abridged. Oh, dear. I read that in a review, and I wanted to test that. The Year of Living Biblically and Drop Dead Healthy. He is a frequent guest on national news, talk shows, and a columnist for Esquire.com, Mental Floss Magazine, and LinkedIn Influencers Program. Please join me in welcoming tonight's featured author, A.J. Jacobs.
Everybody, I use this or yeah, I guess so. Thank you all for coming out. Well, thank you, Nancy and Judy and Marianne and Marlene and the Overflow Room. Thank you guys. Hello. I am just delighted and flattered to be part of Silicon Valley Reads, and I am a huge library supporter. My mother is a docent at the New York Public Library. And we were just, my family and I, my kids and I were watching the Da Vinci Code last week for our family movie, and it had my favorite line from an action thriller ever, which was Tom Hanks says, "We have to get to a library fast." And I was like, yes, you do. Yes, you do. He ended up using the internet, but I like the intention, so we'll stick with the intention. And I agree with him. We all need to get to a library because they are so crucial and wonderful and provide events like this. So I couldn't be happier. Today, as Nancy mentioned, I'm going to be talking about families, the good, the bad, and the ugly of family history. That's the main event. But before that, I thought I'd briefly give a little context about the way that I write. And as Nancy mentioned, I love to immerse myself in my topics, almost become a human guinea pig. Several years ago, for instance, I wanted to learn about religion. And this is because I grew up in New York City with no religion at all. As I say in the book, I'm Jewish, but I'm Jewish in the same way the Olive Garden is Italian. no offense to the Olive Garden. But I had a son, and I wanted to know what to teach him about my heritage. So I thought one way to learn about the Bible might be to dive in and actually live the Bible, follow it as literally as possible. So I got a board of spiritual advisors, rabbis and ministers and priests and scholars, and then I bought a stack of Bibles, and I read them, and I wrote down every single rule that I could find in the Bible. And this turned out to be a very long list, hundreds of rules, and I wanted to follow them without picking and choosing. See how it affected my life. So I wanted to follow the famous ones, like the Ten Commandments and love your neighbor, but I also wanted to follow the lesser-known rules. The Bible says, for instance, that especially in the Old Testament, it talks about how you cannot shave the corners of your beard. I didn't know where the corners were, so I figured I should just let the whole thing grow. And this is the progression. There I am at the end. I spent a lot of time in airport security. That is true. That's and Leviticus also says that you should not wear clothes made of two different kinds of fabrics. So I figured I shouldn't do that. I got rid of all my poly cotton blends. The Bible says, the Hebrew scriptures, they say that you should stone adulterers. So I figured I should at least try. And I was able to stone one adulterer. I'll tell you very quickly. It was towards the middle of the year, and I was really getting into it. So I had the beard, but I also would sometimes wear a robe and sand. The sheep I did not have with me at all times. That was a rental sheep just for like the cover shoot. But sometimes I would go out in New York looking like this, and I was in Central Park, and a guy came up to me and said, "Why are you dressed like this?" And I explained, "I'm trying to follow all the rules of the Bible, from the Ten Commandments to stoning adulterers." And he says, "Well, I'm an adulterer. Are you going to stone me?" And I said, "Well, that would be fantastic." That is a lovely offer. So I took out a handful of stones that I had been carrying for some time, hoping to run into an adult. And they were small. They were like pebble size. I didn't want to go to jail. And I showed them to him. And I was like, you know, this is... And he was very aggressive. He grabbed the stones out of my hand and threw them at me. So I thought, an eye for an eye, I could maybe toss one at him. So that's how I checked that off my list. Now, with the project ended, and I shaved my beard, I put down the pebbles. But actually, it turned out that it was a life-changing project. And there are dozens of things from that year that still affect me and that I still do. I talk about a lot of them in the book, but one that occurs to me is just gratitude, the idea of gratitude. The Bible says that you should be thankful for everything. So I took this literally. So I would, every day, I would press the elevator button. I'd be thankful the elevator came. I got in the elevator. I'd be thankful that it didn't plummet to the basement and break my collarbone. And it was a strange way to live. But it was also wonderful because it made it clear that there are hundreds of things that go right every day that we take for granted. And we focus on the three or four that go wrong. That is very, that is very disconcerting. That is like an infinite number of me. All right, so back to reality. Gratitude was a big lesson. Another lesson was it showed me, I think, the dangers of fundamentalism and trying to live literally by the Bible, because there are millions of people who say, "Oh, I live literally by the Bible, and that's why homosexuality is a sin." And my argument, my takeaway was, no one lives literally by the Bible, or you would be doing what I do, standing on a street corner throwing stones. So... we all cherry pick. The key is to cherry pick the sweet cherries, not the poisonous cherries, because there's so much in the Bible about loving your neighbor and compassion and tolerance. So that was a big takeaway for me. Incidentally, this came out a few years ago. CBS just made a sitcom last year based on the book. It's called Living Biblically. I didn't write it. I just gave him the rights. And the people who did the sitcom were very nice. One was Johnny Galecki, who's on The Big Bang Theory. I didn't think that it was a great show. I don't want to use the word abomination, but it was not. I knew we were in trouble because they early on, CBS said that they would not let the main character grow a beard because that might scare off the viewers. So I knew that we were in for trouble. But actually, it was a fun experience. I've never had a TV show made about me, even if it's not what I wanted. That was one book. I've done several other books about my ongoing quest to be a little bit of a better person. So I wrote one about trying to be the healthiest person alive. So I tried out every diet and exercise routine. I tried to find the healthiest way to walk and talk and sleep and go to the bathroom, because there is a healthier way to go to the bathroom. I won't get into it unless you, if you come afterwards and want to know, I'm happy to tell you. One takeaway from that is that it is not healthy to be overly obsessed with your health. It's very stressful, and stress is not good. My most recent book, which came out just last month, is all about gratitude. So it was actually an offshoot of the Bible book, and it was called Thanks a Thousand, and I travel around the world and try to thank 1,000 people who helped make my cup of coffee possible, because there are hundreds of people there. You know, it's the farmer, but there's the logo designer and the truck driver, the woman who does pest control for the warehouse where my coffee beans are stored. So I try to thank everyone. So that's a window into how I write. And that is the approach that I took with It's All Relative, which is tonight's main course. And this book had a strange beginning, which Nancy made reference to. I was sitting at my desk, and an email pinged, and I opened it up, and it said, Dear Mr. Jacobs, you don't know me, but I'm your 8th cousin. And I was like, oh boy, we know what's going on. He's going to say, here's my Nigerian bank account. Please wire $10,000. But I was wrong. It turns out this man is a dairy farmer who lives on a kibbutz in Israel, and he's part of a group of scientists and researchers who are working on this crazy project, this moonshot. They are building the largest family tree in history. And tree is not quite the right word. It's more of a forest. And it's not hundreds or thousands of people, millions of people all connected on the same tree. And right now it's about 160 million people in dozens of countries, all 7 continents, including Antarctica, because they're scientists in Antarctica. You might be on it without even knowing it. And one part of me was like, oh my God, you know, this is a, do I really want this many relatives? You know, I've already got some relatives now that I'd be happy to cut out of my family. You know, I don't want to single anyone out, but I have a cousin in Las Vegas who hired a stripper for his wedding, dressed as a leprechaun, and I'm like, do I want more of that? But at the same time, there was the non-cynical part of me, which was like, this is really monumental. This is amazing. This is a goal to create the global family tree. That's what they call it, the world family tree. And they want to eventually get to all 7 billion people. And it's there's this almost naive phrase you hear when you're growing up that the human race is one big family. But here, they're actually trying to show it concretely with science, how we are all related. And I said to myself, this is fascinating, and this has to be the topic of my next book. And so it did. It consumed the next 3 years of my life, and it was fascinating. It's a project that could not have happened any other time in history, because a world family tree, it requires several revolutions happening at once, a perfect storm. So first, you've got the DNA testing revolution, where you swab your cheek and you send it in and you can find out your ancestry and find out dozens of distant cousins you never knew you had or wanted. The second revolution is the internet revolution. So the idea of a massive worldwide cooperation, like Wikipedia. So you've got thousands of people working on this puzzle at the same time. And third, there's the information revolution. Just the amount of documents online and newspapers has made it possible. So we are in this golden age of genealogy. It's not this fringe hobby anymore. It is changing the way we see everything, ethnicity and health and politics. It's affecting solving crimes. There was the Golden State Killer just a few months ago who was caught through his cousins and relatives' DNA. So I spent 3 years immersed in this world of family research, and the book that came out is the highlights of what I learned. So partly it is about this idea of the global family tree, which is, it's almost dangerous in how addicting it is, because I spent, when I first discovered and joined it, I spent a week just figuring out how am I related to everyone else in the world, and you know, how am I related to friends from camp, how am I related to famous people, because you enter your name in a search bar with someone else, and it will go through these billions of connections to find, for instance, that I am my cousin Obama, my cousin Barack Obama. He is officially my aunt's fifth great aunt's husband's father's wife's seventh great nephew. So we are very close, very practically brothers. But it is, it's the 6 degrees of Kevin Bacon idea that we are all connected. Also for the book, I looked into the DNA revolution, and I swabbed my cheek and spat many times. So I did all, because there are several different companies, including 23andMe, based right here. And I took them all. All of them did say that I'm Jewish, so they got that right. But there were a surprising amount of variation. You know, these are not, sometime in the future perhaps they'll be perfect, but right now they're a work in progress. They are, so one said I had 14% Scandinavian DNA, and I was all excited. I thought, you know, I can go and get some Gravlax and do some cross-country skiing. But then, like, 3 years later, it dropped to 2%. It was very sad. One of them said, and actually this, I think, said, I am mostly Ashkenazi Jew, but 2.5% Arab Egyptian, which I liked because it's like the Middle East conflict playing out inside my body. And I'm still alive, so it gave me hope that we can do this. These services will also send you a list of names of people who share enough DNA that they are considered your distant cousins. So they send me the list, and I didn't recognize 1,000 people they sent me. I didn't recognize any of the names except for one. I did see one name. It was my wife, Julie Jacobs. So that was exciting. I thought that was kind of cool. I thought, like, this will spice up our marriage. But she was freaked out, so I was told not to discuss it. But our kids are fine. They have, you know, none of them have two or three heads. They're all single-headed. I did a lot of field trips for the book, so I went to the Salt Lake City, because the Mormons are, I use this metaphor in the book, so I'm not just pandering to the crowd. They are the Golden State Warriors of genealogy. They are just amazing. They have billions of records. I enjoyed interviewing. I wanted to find out other people's views on family, what it means to them. So I reached out to a bunch of my cousins. And so I interviewed Ricky Gervais and John Legend. And that's one thing about this world family tree. It is the ultimate social network, because you can reach out to people and say, hey, we're cousins. And some of the time they'll say, please never contact me again. But sometimes it worked. And actually it worked. I wanted to interview George H.W. Bush, because I thought he was the patriarch of a very important family. And so I called this chief of staff, and I said, I'd like to interview. And she said, well, President Bush is not doing any interviews. And I said, well, I understand that, but I just so you know, we are cousins. And she said, well, in that case, let me see what I can do. And I told her, we were like, you know, 12th cousins, three times removed, but still, it worked, and I got to interview the president while he was still Now, part of the book is also my explorations of my my more immediate family, not the 12th cousins, but my actual immediate ancestors. And luckily, I did pick some good ancestors to be descended from. So I have suffragists and peacock salesmen, and my grandfather, my maternal grandfather, who died a few years ago, was an outsized character. His name was Ted Keel. He was a lawyer in New York who wore the loudest clothes you can imagine. He wore a red and white checked suit to my wedding. I'll never forget that. But he was a wonderful man who inspired me. And I learned a lot about him in this project that I didn't know. Partly, I had a good research aid. It was his FBI file. He had a very thick FBI file. But for the right reasons. He wasn't a gangster. He was very involved in the civil rights movement, and J. Edgar Hoover was not a fan. So he had this thick file, and my grandfather represented Martin Luther King in a lawsuit against the Alabama police, and this is from a fundraiser he threw. So there's a lot in the file about my grandfather and Martin Luther King. My grandfather, actually, another thing that I learned more about was that he had started a program that brought students from Africa to the United States to study. And one of those students was named Barack Obama Sr. So I guess he wasn't senior then. That just occurred to me. He would have just been Barack Obama. But yeah, that was very exciting because he is the father of my fifth great aunt's husband's brother's wife, seventh great nephew, Barack Obama. And my grandfather lived long enough to see Obama elected, and he was just tickled. So it was inspiring to learn more about my grandfather. Not all my ancestors were so virtuous, which is good. You want the ne'er-do-wells and the scamps. I mean, that is kind of one of the fun parts of genealogy. And in fact, what I love about genealogy is that there is an expert for everything. So I found this man named Ron Ahrens, who actually lives in the Bay Area. And he's got a company called Black Sheep Research. And his job is he will research your family tree and find all the terrible people in the past, all the murderers and gangsters. And he's quite a character. He'll go to these genealogy conventions and he'll dress up in a costume like black and white striped prison outfit. And he helped me find some of the worst apples in my tree. I didn't have murderers, but I did have a third grade uncle who was very involved in the Teapot Dome scandal, which is a bribery scandal that brought down Warren G. Harding's presidency. And I know it's very hard to imagine corruption in the White House. That's sort of mind blown. We've never seen anything like that again. But another person I found challenging to research was a second great uncle on the other side. His name was Saul Kingsbacher. And there was nothing on him. I looked in all of the census, all the regular documents. I finally found one mention of him in all of history. And this was in a newspaper. And it was an advertisement where he gave an endorsement to a hemorrhoid cream. So that is Saul Kingsbacher. And on the one hand, it's kind of heartbreaking because, like, this is his entire legacy as a human being. So I'm not helping by showing it, so I apologize. But on the other hand, I can rationalize it because part of the importance of studying family history is to look at the highlights and the lowlights, the ups and the downs, the wins, the losses, the successes, and the failures. And the experts talk about, there was this famous study done by Emory University, and it said that it found that kids who had been taught family history were actually happier and more well-adjusted than those who didn't. And why is this? And the hypothesis that the psychologist came up with is that it wasn't the parents who just gave the names and dates. It was the parents who told stories of the ancestors, and not just any stories. The warts and all stories, the good and the bad, what he called the oscillating narrative, so the ups and the downs. And that's what we need to teach kids. We have to say, look, here's our family. We've had successes. We've had doctors who founded hospitals, but we've also had failures. We've had people who went bankrupt and houses that burned down. But the key point is that we persevered. As a family, we stayed together and we worked through it. And that is the lesson we need to impart. So again, this idea of family history, it's not an inconsequential hobby. It's got consequences on how we raise our kids. And increasingly, it's got consequences in the real world. Because it's a very powerful tool. And like any tool, it can be used for good or it can be used for ill. Like any technology, as we've seen right here in Silicon Valley. Some parts of social networks are wonderful. Love seeing my sister's daughters on the beach. Some parts, like subverting our democracy, not so good. So the idea is that genealogy is going to have these big consequences. I am a techno-optimist, so I do believe the good will outweigh the bad, but I thought I'd wrap up before the Q&A, because I'd happily answer any questions, that go over what I see are some of the possible good consequences of this revolution and then some of the dangers. So on the good side is the idea that my hope is that it will remind us this idea, this simple but profound idea, that we are one big family. And I think it's a message we need right now because we're seeing a rise in tribalism. But we need to be reminded that we share, everyone on Earth shares upwards of 99.5% of DNA. And the hope is it'll make us just a little bit kinder. And I have three boys, and I see how they wrestle. So I know that it doesn't always lead to kumbaya. At the same time, there is hard evidence that people treat their family with more kindness than strangers. There is a fascinating study from Harvard a couple of years ago where they had Israelis and Palestinians, and they took one group and told them how closely knit they were, how closely related they were. And another group, they didn't say anything. And the group that was told that they were related, even if it was like eighth cousins, treated each other with more kindness, was more willing to negotiate than the others. So my hope is that we can use this bias for good. And I've actually seen it in myself, anecdotally. I call it, for myself, I call it the Judge Judy effect. Because, Judge Judy, the TV. So I always hated her. I found her like the most abrasive, obnoxious character on our media landscape. And then I found out she was my sixth cousin. And I was like, you know what? She's not so bad. She's just Judge Judy. She's just doing her shtick. She's probably a sweetheart, which I know is irrational, but I couldn't help it. A second hope is that it will help erode tribalism and racism. Because one of the big findings from this is that we are all mutts. Henry Louis Gates is featured in this book, and he's the Harvard professor with the show Finding Your Roots. And that's one of his big crusades, this idea that racial purity is a myth. That, for instance, the average African-American has 24% European DNA. And the average white American is also much more mixed than people think. So the hope is when we realize that we are all a mix, that it will help. And it's been fascinating to watch because there have been instances of white supremacists, for instance, taking these DNA tests. And some of the results find, you know, they have a portion of ancestry that is African American or Jewish, and sometimes they'll deny it. They'll just say, "Oh, this is these services are multicultural conspiracy." But sometimes, not always, sometimes they can make the turn. It's like a Spielberg movie. They like, you know, they realize, "Oh my God, this way I'm living is not the right way." So my hope is it will erode differences. And not just between ethnicities. In my book, I have a story of a meteorologist in Texas who he was adopted and he wanted to find his biological mom. So he did one of these tests and he was able to locate her. The trick was, he's gay, and his mom, biological mom, is evangelical Christian, and saw his lifestyle as sinful. So, but just meeting face to face made all the difference, and they've come to an understanding and come to have a relationship. There's also the possibility of medical breakthroughs. There are scientists I feature in the book who are studying this world family tree with millions of people to see how, what genes are linked, are correspond to longevity. So that's exciting. There's the crime-fighting element that I mentioned with the Golden State Killer, for instance. Another part of this family revolution that I love is the idea that it is broadening our sense of family. Because it's making us consider family in a new way. One of my favorite stories from the book is about a twins who are twin women. They're now in their 30s, and they were born in Korea, but separated at birth, and both adopted to homes in the United States. And they didn't know about each other until Facebook, someone noticed how eerily similar they look, and they got together, and they found out they were identical twins. And what's interesting is they tried to reach out to their biological mom, but she, for whatever reason, didn't want anything to do with them, which you would think would be crushing, and it was upsetting to them. But they talk about how they consider, they hope to be in touch with their biological mom someday, but they say they still feel they have several moms. They've got one mom, their adoptive mom, their sister's adoptive mom. One is an actress and has her manager. She calls her momager. So I love this idea that we've re-examined what it means to be family, and it's not all DNA. It doesn't have to all be biological. There's one of the people I talked to in the book talked about, you've got your biological family, but also your logical family. These are the people who, they could be coworkers, friends, godparents. These are the people who support you. And to me, that's wonderful, because I think, you know, like my seventh cousin three times removed, Hillary Clinton, says, not to drop names, but it takes a village. So I'm all for the bigger, expansive family. All right, so now, on the other hand, there are some dangers that I'll go over quickly, because as I say, I'm a techno-optimist, so I'm really hoping the good outweighs the bad, but we should acknowledge that there are that we're at an inflection point, and depending on how we act, I mean, there is the chance that these DNA tests, instead of doing what we hope, will actually inflame racism and tribalism. I've read articles about white supremacists online who are having contests to see who has the highest percentage of European ancestry. There was a, what it seemed to me like quite a public relations fiasco when Elizabeth Warren revealed that she was part Native American, because she got flack from both sides. You got the conservatives who made fun of her, but then you had the left, some on the left who said she was appropriating her Native American heritage without having contributed. She had never been interested in Native rights. You've got privacy issues. I don't know if you remember the movie Gattaca, but you know, now that our DNA is in these databases, there's a fear that future employers will get to see him, you know, or you'll go on a date and your date will be able to scan you and say, oh, he's got the gene for non-monogamous behavior. Forget it. So that's a fear. Another downside is just unpleasant surprises, because an estimated 2% of the world's population has a father who is not the father they presume. And this is going to be more and more clear as more people take. And I have a story in the book that's sort of an extreme example of this. It's a guy in the Midwest who had 8 siblings, and the father died, and they got a little piece of his hair, and they did a test, and it turned out, no, wait, sorry, he's 9 siblings. It turned out that 8 of them had different fathers. So 8 different fathers for 9 siblings. And it was like a Maury Povich show to the nth degree. Now, I will say, just to give you some hope, there was a wonderful part of the story, because the father, who knew he was not the biological dad, it was clear later, but he still treated these kids as if they were his own biological kids. And I love that, because, again, it shows biology does not always equal family. But other people I interviewed did not have a positive experience, I've gotten emails that it's ripping this family apart. My mother and father are separating. So there is that danger. I do, though, once again, believe the good of having a global family will outweigh the bad, and which is why in the book, I end the book by writing about a celebration of this idea, because part of the book is my quest to throw the biggest family reunion ever, to throw a family reunion for all 7 billion cousins. So I invited all 7 billion. Not all came. We didn't get 100% turnout. You guys were invited. It was on my website if you had gone there. But we did get, surprisingly, we got 4,000 people in New York City, and there were 40 simultaneous branch parties around the world, all over, from New Zealand to India to Mexico. And so it may not have been the biggest party ever, but it was certainly one of the strangest days of my life, because you had this crazy quilt of humanity, all types of ethnicities. You had a rabbi, an imam, and a minister walk on stage, so, like the joke, but that was real. We had an atheist who come just to balance things out. Henry Louis Gates gave a talk. There was this conglomeration of sort of C-list celebrities, like David Blaine was there, and my teenage crush, Mary Lou Henner from Taxi, she was there. We got Sister Sledge to come, and they sang We Are Family. And I sang on stage with them, very quietly. No one needed to hear my voice. And I will, just to be honest, because I like to be transparent, we actually did not have all the sisters Sledge. There are 4 sisters. This is 3 of them and 1 of their daughter, because apparently one of the sisters Sledge they don't get along with, which is like crushing, because they sing the anthem, We Are Family, except for this one, who we don't really like. So family's complicated. That's another big takeaway. But it was I was miserable the whole day because I was just super stressed that something was going to go wrong and someone would slip and break their wrist and sue me. But other people said they had a good time. Apparently, there was a lot of spontaneous hugging, which, again, is not my thing, but I was happy other people did it. There was a lot of, hey, cousin, you're my cousin, and then trying to figure out how. It was all about connections, and that, again, is the theme of the book, connections, which I really do think we need in these divisive times. So with that, I will open it up to questions. And I will say again, thank you for having me. And you're all invited to my house for Thanksgiving next year, since we're all related. So see you then. Thank you.
Which one did you find took you back the furthest?
That's a good question. Yeah, I did them all, and I have in the back of the book sort of a guide to the four or five big ones because they all have their pros and cons. They're all actually very good at what they do. For the farthest, I think it was Family Tree DNA does the why. There's several different kinds of tests, and it's been a while, so I can't remember all the details, but Y DNA for men is the one that goes way back.
So when you say way back?
Thousands of years.
Thousands.
Right.
So I could maybe go back as far as my 11th great-grandfather in the 1500s?
Yeah. I mean, they won't provide names. You're not going to get a list like Jebediah, whatever. But they will. You will see where that came from, and it's basically the son of the son of the son of the son of the son. So it's one. You know, if you think of your ancestors as a big funnel, a big upside down pyramid, it's just the one line that's coming, and that's something you have to think about is just how many ancestors we have, because it doubles every time, you know, two parents, four grandparents, eight great grandparents. So, you know, when people say they're from royalty, that's wonderful. But statistically, everyone in this room is probably from royalty because we have so many thousands of ancestors. So, you know, you can feel good about that.
Another question?
When you were doing your own research as opposed to having people do research for you, about what percentage of that was like pure, you know, computer-based looking things up, and how much was actually, you know, pounding the books and looking at pictures and images and
right.
Fashion technology?
That's a good question. Everyone heard it, yes? I'd say most of it was online because it is amazing what's online now, but not everything. There's a lot of documents that are still unscanned. And one of my trips was to Salt Lake City, to the Family History Library, owned by the LDS Church. And by the way, I spoke at the LDS convention, like their genealogy convention. It was, first of all, the biggest crowd I've ever spoken to and ever will speak to, unless I put out a number one hit. It was like 8,000 people, mostly LDS. And I was the warm-up act for Donny Osmond, which is very stressful because I imagine they're too polite. As a people, they're very polite, so they wouldn't say it. But I'm sure they were just like, all right, let's get to Donny. But anyway, they have an amazing facility, the Family History Library, and they've got one in every city. But I found some things in there. I found a wedding announcement. I guess it was a wedding document from Poland, from I think it was my fourth great grandmother, and it, you know, it is something. There's something about seeing it in. You know, seeing the actual document, and there's also, it drove home some of the sacrifices that my ancestors made and how hard life was. Because this, I think it was my fourth great grandma, she was married when I think she was 17 and he was 18, and it was Poland. And so I was happy for them. And at the same time, I was like, you're so young. It's funny because the people who've been doing genealogy for decades are kind of annoyed by how much is available online. Because they're like, I used to have to drive 3 hours to the Cleveland Public Library, you know, or the courthouse and get these documents. These guys don't know what how easy they have it. But it is, as I say, it's a golden age for family history.
Anyway. I either read or heard someplace something that I don't know if it's an urban legend, but that in the world there are millions of people who are related to Genghis Khan for obvious reasons. And I wonder if you ran into that, have any comment, is it true?
Yeah, I do talk a bit about that in the book. And apparently there is, he has millions of descendants. Two things. One, he was more prolific than your average man at that era. Because, you know, he had a lot, I don't know how consensual they were, but he had a lot of relations. But at the same time, as I said, statistically, it's not all that impressive because we all share so many ancestors. I mean, it is astounding when you look back how many thousands of ancestors we have, meaning how many millions of offspring. And assuming that the human race continues, knock on wood, our 12th great grandkids, I will share a 12th great grandkid with everyone in this room because of the way the genealogy works. So yes, he did have a lot of kids, but I mean offspring and descendants, but so does everyone else.
So we have two questions from the overflow room.
Oh, good for the overflow room.
The first one is, greetings from the overflow room.
Doesn't sound like a question.
Who is your favorite cousin?
Whoever asked that question, of course, is my favorite cousin. But that's a great question. I am very moved by my grandfather and all that he did. That's a stumper. I will say, how about this one? One of my favorite cousins is named Luca, L-U-C-A, and that stands for Last Universal Common Ancestor. And he is my 1.1 billionth great-grandparent. I don't know if it's a he or a she. I don't want to gender assign. It is the first living cell ever, first DNA strand. And every living thing on Earth is descended from it. So you, me, a fern, a boa constrictor, Dwayne the Rock Johnson, we are all descended from this one little tiny creature that lived by an underwater volcano. And I love that fact. So he is, or she, is one of my heroes.
Thank you. And the second question is, did you get into the Guinness Book of World Records?
Well, it's interesting. The Guinness Book of which I talk about in this book, because I wanted to have the official record for the largest family reunion. I thought that would be cool. So when I started the book, the official record was 2,300, which was a family in West Virginia. In the middle of the book, I was looking at the website, Guinness website, it went up to 5,000, some family in France. So they totally screwed me. While I was writing the book, I'm like, I can do 23, but fine. So the other thing that I learned is that Guinness, and part of their business model is that you have to pay them a lot of money to get. So, you can do it yourself, but it's really hard. But if you hire one of the Guinness, I forget what they call it, officials, then I mean, it reminded me of like when you get those emails like, you want to can be in Who's Who of American Journalists for just $300. So that, and I couldn't afford like their $20,000 package. So I had a friend, luckily, a cousin, who had started a Guinness competitor. It was more like the Wikipedia, the sort of upstart. It was called Record Setters. It's still around. And so he came, and we did break. We didn't, you know, as I said, we got 4,000 in one place. So we didn't break the 5,000, but we did have 40 simultaneous parties. So we hold that record on Record Setters. And, you know, people say, oh, you got the world record? I'm like, sure, I got the world record. They don't need to know that it's record. No one's looking at the fine print. So yes, in a sense, we broke the world record. And in a sense, we totally did not. Yes.
I loved your book, Biblically.
Oh, thank you.
It's the only one I couldn't read in the library because I was laughing so hard I had to go outside.
You're making me commit the sin of pride. That's what I always say.
Were you able to use any of the information from Biblically, particularly the Old Testament, and in particular the story of Noah with the sons Shem, Ham, and Japheth, I can never pronounce that, who settled various parts of the world. Mm. And do you think it would be plausible, or did you consider that when you were writing this book?
Oh, that's such an interesting question. I'm trying to think. I mean, I do talk about the Bible and the genealogies in the Bible, because that is a large part of those go on for pages, the begets. They were very interested in that. I mean, the first part of the Bible is all about descendants, fertility, genealogy. That is Genesis. Since I saw the Bible more as more allegorical than historical, I didn't really spend a lot of time trying to find, how exactly I am, which tribe I'm descended from. Although, what's interesting is these websites call the ones with the World Family Tree called genie.com and wikitree.com. There are two levels to them. There's the well-documented level, where they have, you know, DNA tests, and they've got census forms, and it's pretty well-documented. And that goes back about, depending on the line, it can go back 5 generations or 10 generations. But some people on there are a little more lax and a little more willing to take the leap of faith. So if you put in King David, you will see that I am his 99th great-grandson. So I am officially descended from King David. Semi-officially.
I'll come back to you.
I don't have a question, but it's an odd coincidence. I was interested in your uncle, Kingsbaker.
Hmm.
And it's an odd connection because I was born on the same block as he. I think we're different generations, but I don't have the same problem he had. But the other point,
there's
point
no
is,
shame in
that's
it. No shame.
Predominantly an Italian neighborhood, Ohio Street, Chicago.
That's fascinating. I did not know. And you just figured that it's not like you knew the Kingsbakers. It's just because it showed up on there. That is very odd. I love it. Well, that is one of the other things about genealogy that I love, are all the coincidences. And sometimes I think people read a little too much into it. They're like, oh, you know, my second great-grandpa was a fisherman. That's why I love having a beach house. You know, it's I'm not sure. But but it is fun. It is fun.
And your
last question?
Yes. Oh, I do have a question. Several years ago, I had my DNA tested, got the results, and my question is, if I had it done again, would there be any changes? Because I know that the companies have greatly increased their database.
Yes,
I actually, well, they should have your DNA on file. They don't need to take it again. But, and I assume they update it. So I don't know if you've checked the website. You might want to do that because, yes, the truth is that they do adjust. You know, you probably won't be completely, you know, you won't be an Inuit, but you will, it will adjust. Like, as I said, I think it was Ancestry. When I took it about 4 years ago, I was 14% Scandinavian. And then I had this mysterious disappearing Scandinavian ancestors. And it was just because of that. It was the database. They calculate your percentages based on several algorithms. But one piece of data they use is comparing it to other people in the database who say that they have a paper trail going back to, say, Scandinavia. So if you have a database that's lopsided, that has, you know, tons of Scandinavia, which is what happened with Ancestry early on, then you're going to get an outsized percentage. So as my friend Cece Moore, who's great, she's got she's one of the people who works on these cold cases. She's a DNA, she's a genealogist, a genetic genealogist. But her simple rule of thumb was, you know, believe, you can believe the Northern European, Southern European, you can believe, you know, Africa, but once they get into the micro details like Scotland versus Ireland, we don't have that data yet for sure. That's a lot of speculation. So do it, but just don't take it as total science yet. There's still a little art, a little horoscopishness to it. Well, I had a wonderful time. Thank you again, cousin. Oh, and oh, thanks. And by the way, I'm going to sign books and or answer more questions if you have any. Just I guess right outside, right?
That's right. I want to thank you again for coming. I think you liked it, and AJ is willing to sign books, and the bookseller is willing to stay for another little while. So enjoy yourselves, and if you liked the program, I encourage you to pick up one of these brochures. They're all around the library. And look through them. There are, I think Nancy said, 140 events happening in the next 2 months. And I think you'll find a lot of them quite interesting. So look through them and come to another one. Thank you for coming.
Thank you, everybody.